register now.
Hello students, a very warm welcome to all of you. Your AG ma'am, your Anubha ma'am is back with the third session of periodic classification, and trust me, sadly this is going to be the last one for chapter number 5 and for your syllabus. Don't worry, you must be thinking, ma'am, we were waiting for one shot videos of the previous chapter. Some are done and some are in process. You will get each and every chapter's one shot video. Trust your Anubha ma'am and be with me till the end, because this session is super duper important, because questions can definitely and will definitely come from this topic. All right, so give me a quick thumbs up and a high five and share your love by definitely liking the video, sharing it to your friends and subscribing to the channel if you're new. All right everyone, before starting I just want to take a few minutes of yours, because this is important specifically for all the new students, so that they got to know that how all of their problems can be solved at this platform. Like if your doubts are not getting solved instantly while you are reading something, while you're in class or in any mode of learning, this is the platform where your doubts can be solved instantly with the help of master teachers and a team of class teachers totally dedicated to solve your doubts. So it will happen definitely. Notes of the session, like generally students were saying, their 70% time goes in this only and might not able to read effectively and can give time for revision. Definitely possible, because you will get the notes with all the important questions, test in 15 days, assignment with all the twisted type of a question, so that you will not say, ma'am, question is out of syllabus. It's definitely in there, sometimes you just missed it. Competitive exams preparation, like side by side JEE, NEET and Olympiad, may be totally possible. The best part is with the choice of your own schedule. You can manage accordingly. You can fit Vedanta schedule in your own schedule. It's student centric platform with the choice of your own language. I must say only Hindi and English I'm talking about here. And all of the problems with so much of bonuses, you will like problems will be solved and bonuses you will get in terms of attending in unlimited live session. All micro courses like chapter based courses to make sure, suppose you're reading chapter number 4 and you need to revise chapter number 1 or 2, definitely possible. All of the micro courses, chapter based courses, live courses will be available at the same time. Performance report of every session in terms of having quizzes in all the session to make sure learning is active and you will be able to learn and see your name in the leaderboard. Personalized attention of the teachers to make sure that you're on the right path and get all the guidance and motivation from the same. Okay, so the solution is, there is a link in the description box pinned by Vedantu 19 channel, that buy pro courses. Just click on it, this page will come. Select your grade, my 10th class students, select your target CBSE 2021, and you can get your required subscription from three models that we have. That's 1 month, 3 and 6 months. Now which one is best? I must say all of it for sure. It's just the monetary benefit that you can have if you'll apply the code AGEPRO. AG ma'ams, E for English channel, pro is this course. So AGEPRO will save 20 to 31 to 43% on your MRP. Choose your course wisely, I would say. 1 month for a shorter period of time to revise few chapter, 3 months definitely to make sure you'll get all the fast track and revision courses, and in these 3 months when your exam will come, you'll be better prepared and surely can secure above 90 if you'll believe in yourself and this platform, definitely. So do not forget AGEPRO, do not forget to visit the link. This is something I wanted to tell you. And what are we going to learn today? Trends in periodic table. As I said, the most important video of the topic of the chapter, that how different properties are going to change along a period and in a group. All right everyone, period is, I think I told in the last session too, to remember that with the help of HPVG. Harsh Priyam sir is very generous, I think you know that. You can also say Hari Prasad, very generous. That means horizontal is my period, vertical is my group. All right, horizontal is my period and vertical is my group. And I told in the last session to understand modern periodic table that we have 7 horizontal periods and 18 groups. We'll talk about how properties are going to change in the same. So super ready? Yeah. Let's begin then. Let's begin. I hope all of you remember periodic table well. And let me just, you know, giving you a quick recap. What exactly is this? 1 to 2 to 3 to these 12, 13 to 18. These are the groups that we have. And these are some special blocks that we are going to have missing elements from here. This 1 to 2 is my S block. This 3 to 12 is my D block. 13 to 18 is my P block. And this is my F block. SPDF basically represent the next model that you're going to learn in 11th class, that how electrons are present in specific orbitals as well. Orbit will be having orbitals, like how the electrons will rotate on its own axis, just like Earth is rotating on its own axis. And you'll get these 4 type of orbitals, SPDF. S means the last electron, valence electron is going to that S orbital. D means D orbital, P and F. That's what it is. And we'll talk about all the properties, that how any of the property changes when we move from left to right in the table along a period, and top to bottom, that means along a group. So super ready for the same? So without missing a single second, let's start right now. Let's talk about first of all valency and valence electron. Quite important topic, as you know very well from 9th class as well. So what is valency? I hope you remember it. Valency is determined by the number of valence electron. Yeah, in 9th class I generally tell my students a small trick to remember, that if your valence electron is from 1 to 4, that means at that time your valence electron will represent the valency 2, equal to. And if your valence electron is 5 to 8, your valency will be 8 minus valence electron. I hope you will agree with me as well. Yeah, because the topic has not been changed. The valency definition has not been changed. Now you will be like, ma'am, how to do that? Please help me. What are you saying? So don't worry, ma'am will help you. Valency, suppose I'm talking about sodium, configuration is 281. Valence electron 1, valency 1. When I talk about silicon, 284, valency 4, as same as the valence electron. When I talk about chlorine, configuration is 287, valency will be 1, 8 minus 7, that's 1. Because what exactly is valency, students? Valency is the combining capacity of an element. Valency tells that how an atom, how an element is going to combine with the other element. And element will be having 3 options while combining. Either it will lose electron, either it will gain electron, or it will share its electron with other atom. And finally, all of these hard work just to have a stable configuration, just to follow octet rule. Pardon me, just for first shell, I'll talk about the duplet rule. For all the shell, octet rule, but for the first shell, it will be duplet rule. So combining capacity means how many electron an element will lose or gain or to share to follow a stable configuration. And I hope with the enough example, you can able to understand the same. I wrote the configuration here for magnesium and sulfur as asked into the question, and they're asking about the valency. Do remember that my metals generally have 1, 2 or 3 valence electron in the last shell. 1, 2 or 3. When I talk about non-metals, 5, 6, 7, 8. 4 is like a combination of some metals and some non-metals. So supposedly, let's right now we'll take into non-metals, though it has mostly metals. But that I'll tell you later. Metals, something 1 to 3 valence electron and metals has this capacity to donate electron. I hope you already know that metal donates electron. And whatever the number of electron they'll donate, that will become its valency, because they'll donate to have a stable configuration, that to follow the octet rule. So it will lose 2 electron and will show a valency of plus 2. Why plus? Because these are the number of electron lost and your element is going to get a positive charge. Electron negative charge is lost, your atom will become 2 positive. When I talk about sulfur, on the other hand, non-metals has this capacity of gaining electron. Generally, I'm talking about 5, 6, 7 because it is already following its octet and will not gain and it will not lose or share anything. 5, 6, 7 in general, it believes in gaining of electron to follow octet. 6, that means it will accept 2 electrons, so its valency will be minus 2, whatever is the number of electron gain or loss. When you talk about having valency 4, like silicon, like carbon, they generally believes in sharing of electron, and sharing does not give charge to any of the element. So for sharing, no charge. For losing, plus charge. For gaining, negative charge. And you can represent charge as well on the valency. When it's lost and gained, you can also call it ionic valency, electrovalency, because that's due to, you know, loss and gain, positive and negative charge, electrovalency. When that is due to sharing, you can also call it covalency, because covalent bonding will be formed and there will be no charge at all. So let's talk about right now how this valency will change when you move in a period, and also when you move in a group. When you move left to right, when you move top to bottom, this is the valency table will definitely help you. So when I talk about this group 1, I hope you remember, let me revise. For group number 1, 2, 2, valence electron is also 1, 2, exactly same. And the second group that's important for us is P block, that is element from 13 to 18. And how to decide their group number, students? Group number will be 10 plus valence electron, or vice versa. Like valence electron will be group number minus 10. Okay, so 13 means it's having 3 valence electron, 10 plus 3, that's why group number 13. 14 group valency 4, 15 valency 5, not valency, I'm talking about valence electron. 16 valency 2, 17 valency 1, and 18 valency 0. In talking about valence electron, just look at the last number, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. These are the valence electron. Here, 1 valence electron, 2. So let's talk about, first of all, valence electron. Then we will talk about the valency. So let me take an example of a particular group. Let me clear the space as well. Let's see the third period. Period is what? Period is the horizontal row. I took lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. I think you can see everything is written over there in terms of valency, but just to make sure that you'll get it properly, I am writing it down. What? Valency and electronic configuration. Electronic configuration will always help you to decide all the factor. So I must say, at least up to 20 elements, you should know how to write the elements with its configuration. You should know their group number and period number. You should know up to calcium how the elements are present. Okay, so what will be something that's happening to valence electron? Valence electron, when you move in a period, that always increase by 1, because that's what you see. There's an increase in atomic number by 1. Atomic number increase means a number of proton and a number of electron is also increasing by 1. So 1 valence electron, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Valence electron increases when you move from left to right. When I talk about valency, and if I not consider the charge like positive or negative, 1 electron you can lose, 2, 3, up to 3 you can lose. 4 sharing, valency will be 4, 5, 8 minus 5, 3 valency, 2 valency, 1 valency, 0. Or you can also say plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, because these are the number of electron lost. 4, no loss, no gain. Generally, you can say 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 3 gain, 2 gain, and 1 gain, and then it's 0. So it's pretty much clear what is happening to valency. In exam, you'll write this much only, that first increases and then decreases. This much you should know. Valency first increases, then decreases. Is it pretty clear? So what about in a group? What do you say? As I told you that valence electron will be represented by its group number. It's so easy to calculate its valency. Group number 1, 1 valence electron, 2 valence electron, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Valence electron, I wrote it down, that give the information about the valency to valency of a particular group will always remain same. Valence electron 1, that means valency 1. So the entire family will be showing valency 1. Valence electron 2, 2 electron will be lost by each and every element of the same group, valency 2. Valency 3. So in a group, valency remains same as valence electron remains same. So this part is pretty much clear, students. Left to right, first increase, then decrease, valency. Top to bottom, valency remain same. Yeah, all right. Let's talk about the next part, which is super, super important from exam point of view. That's atomic size. How atomic size changes when you move from left to right and top to bottom. Atomic size, let's understand what exactly is this, which is also called as atomic radius or atomic radii. All right. Now, so it's pretty much obvious that term gave you the answer how to calculate it. What will be atomic radius? The distance between the center of the nucleus to the outermost shell in which electron is there of an isolated atom. I'm talking about a single atom. So this is very difficult to calculate. First of all, you know that most of the substances are in the solid form and tightly packed with each other. So first you need to isolate a single atom by giving that much amount of heat that you'll get that atom in gaseous form. So the force of attraction will be totally overcame. Yeah, so atomic size is what distance between the center of the nucleus to the outermost shell in which electron is there of an isolated atom. That's how you calculate the size. But the question is, ma'am, what will happen if we have diatomic molecule, just like hydrogen, just like chlorine, just like other oxygen and all? So students, when atoms are just overlapping each other and making bond, at that time, how to calculate its atomic size? Take the distance between the center of the nucleus of their bond, that's called as bond length, and just make half of it. That will give you the atomic size or atomic radius. Yeah, you can also call it d by 2, bond length by 2, half of the bond length. Bond length, distance between the center of the nucleus of these two atoms which are making a bond, and half of it will represent the atomic size. All right. Now the point is how to know that in a period how much size is, you know, increasing or decreasing while moving this or this. Let's talk about first of all hydrogen. The very first element means the minimum size, and hydrogen is having a size of 37 picometer. Picometer is what? Just like meter, centimeter, a unit to measure size, I mean distance and size. Picometer, 10 to the power minus 12 meter. 1 meter's 1 upon 10 to the power 12th part, which is very, very small, right? Just like nanometer, 10 to the power minus 9, pico is 10 to the power minus 12. All right. Now see, everything is written in front of you. There's a particular period in front of you. Why I'm talking about this is a particular period. How to decide this is period number 2, students? The number of shells represent the period number. Number of shell represents the period number. Please do not forget it. Okay, so when I write boron's configuration, that's 2, 3, and beryllium 2, 2, oxygen 2, 4, some random numbers are written, lithium 2, 1, carbon 2, 4. All of the elements are written in a random order, but what we see, all of the elements are having two shells, means that belongs to period number 2, and their distance is given in picometer. Some is having large distance, some is having less distance. How to figure it out, that what will happen when we move in a period, and on what basis I can tell this answer? So what are the factors? There are two factors on which my atomic size depends. Please, it's very important, listen to me. One is number of shell. As I told in the last example, there were two shells, and we have this thought that every element is having two shells only, so they all must have the same size. But can't we see that there is a difference in the size, though all of it is having only two shell? So there is a one more factor, that is nuclear charge. These are the two factors. Dominating is most of the time number of shells, but what about the period that's having the same number of shell? Then this factor will work over there. That is nuclear charge, and the name is giving you answer, charge on the nucleus. Right, so when I'm moving from lithium to beryllium to boron to carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon, what am I doing? I am moving into the same period, lithium is having +3 charge on the nucleus. Charge on the nucleus is due to proton. Nuclear charge on the nucleus, that's due to proton. That's positive power, and that it is applying to the electron to attract it. Opposite attract, right? So nuclear charge is that force of attraction which your nucleus is applying to the electrons to pull it, because opposite attract. Beryllium +4, +5, +6, +7, +8, +9 and +10. So can you please tell me, what do we see? That when we move in a period, my nuclear charge is increasing already by 1, but number of shell remains same. So what will happen to the size? What will happen to the size due to increase in nuclear charge? It tends to pull the electron closer, right? And that will reduce the size of atom. Yes, students, do you agree with me? Yes or no? So in this period that I wrote it down, from lithium to fluorine, generally we don't consider neon here, because neon is a noble gas and present already into the free form. So that size can vary a bit. So we'll talk about from lithium to fluorine. That means my group number 1 to group number 17. All right. What do we see? Increase in charge means pulling the electron strongly. So size decreases means my group number 1 is having the maximum size in period. My group number 1 is having maximum size in the respective period. All right. That means period number 2, group 1, lithium. Period number 3, sodium will be the one maximum size. And group 17, minimum size. All right, of that respective period. This is pretty much clear, hopefully. Okay, what exactly is this? This is my group number 1. It's written. Now, as I told you, there are two dominating factors. Please don't forget this. This is my lithium. That's 2-1. Sodium 281, rubidium 28, okay, potassium, let's write potassium as well, and let me clear the space. All right. Yes, potassium will be 2881, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium 281881, cesium 2818181. So students, I wrote the configuration. Just please remember this order. When you move in a period, how many elements are there in a particular period? Just remember this pattern. 2 8 8 18 18 32. It will help you. What about the 7? That's incomplete, so we don't define any number to it. So what do we see? As I told, two factors are important: nuclear charge and size, I mean number of shell. Nuclear charge is more dominating factor when we move in a period, because number of shell remains same. When I see a significant factor, that's always number of shell. And when you move in a group, just see that every time an extra shell is coming. So for suppose lithium 2 shell, for sodium 3 shell, for potassium 4, for rubidium 5, and you can easily see that the number of shell are increasing, so size will definitely increase. All right, so this part is also pretty much clear. This is an important question. In a period, size decreases due to effective nuclear charge increases and pulling the electron more strongly down the group. Number of shell increases, and that's how atomic size is also going to increase. I'm teaching you on the basis of NCERT, whatever is important for you. All right, so please do not forget that. You will get the notes by downloading the files also, so it's totally fine. And look at this, there are so many sizes written there to show you. See, lithium to neon size is somewhat getting decreased. You can observe that. Look at a period, size is somewhat getting increased, right? That's what we get to know. Now, this is also very important and interconnected with one more trend that you should know. Metallic and non-metallic properties, somehow you can also say electropositive and electronegative kind of a behavior as well. Like electropositive character and electronegative character, that will work simultaneously. Your metallic elements will show electropositive character. Your non-metallic elements will show electronegative character. So what's written, let's understand one by one. When I talk about metals, everyone, you know that when you see the periodic table, most of it is having metals only. Almost 70 and more there are metals. So this green color, light green color, is representing the entire metal. This yellow color is representing non-metal. And this border where metals are, you know, done and non-metal started, these borders, borderline elements, are having mixed property of metals and non-metals and called as semi-metals or metalloids, right? I'll tell you about all of these, member. So can't you see from this particular diagram as well, this particular picture, that there are so many metals, then non-metal? Means from metallic we are going to non-metallic, from metallic character, non-metallic character, means there might be a possibility metallic character decreases from left to right and non-metallic character increases. A bit of idea, but I'll clear that idea too. Yes. So this is clear, that left hand of the periodic table metal, right hand of the periodic table, if we see, that's carrying non-metals. In between, there are some members called as metalloid semi-metals and exhibit the property of both. Okay, and these members are boron, silicon, germanium, arsenic, antimony, tellurium. These are the one called as metalloids, mixed property. Here, metals. Here, non-metals. All right. So let's talk about their behavior and property. If I talk about metals, metals have a tendency to lose electron, and when metal lose their electron, they get a positive charge. Pretty much obvious. So they are electropositive in nature. Just look at this example. Sodium 281, sodium lost its one electron and now sodium became Na positive. They are electropositive in nature and get a positive charge. So what is a metallic character, students? How you will define metallic character, question can come. Tendency of an element to donate electron in a chemical reaction. And it's also measuring the ease of an element to donate that electron to form a chemical bond. Like a better definition, a measure, an ease with of an element to donate an electron, ease of an element to donate electron to combine with the other elements, to make a bond with the other elements, that will show metallic behavior. And you itself think that if in the last shell there is only one electron, that's so easy to donate two, the ease will become a bit difficult, a bit more. Ease will be a bit less. For three electron, there will be still ease to donate electron, but a bit less. 4, 5, 6, 7 electron, you can't lose at all. That means when I talk about metallic property, we see, suppose I'm making you understand with the help of a particular period. Lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon, I won't talk about, as I discussed, noble gas. All right. So what do you observe here, students? You know that one electron easy to lose, ease to lose electron is, you know, good. Two electron, there will be ease but less. Three, yeah, there will be ease but again less. 4, 5, 6 electron, not a good deal to lose. You will be needing a tremendous amount of energy. That means here it's pretty clear that metallic character, also called as electropositive character, tendency to lose electron and get a positive charge, decreases. Yeah, and non-metallic character is just opposite to it. For 1 to 3, they have more tendency to lose electron. 4, more of a tendency to share electron. 5, 6, 7, they have more tendency to gain electron. And you know that non-metallic character will be again ease of an element to gain electron, to acquire a stable configuration, to combine with the other element. One electron, maximum ease to gain. Two electron, there is ease but less. Three electron, there is ease but again less. So here, when I talk about non-metallic character decreases from fluorine to lithium, and vice versa, if I move from lithium to fluorine, non-metallic character increases, means electronegative character increases. Why electronegative? Opposite of your metallic, electropositive. Non-metallic is having a tendency to get a negative charge, electronegative character. So I hope that's pretty much obvious, that when we talk about, there's also one more way to explain it, like more elaboratively, so that when you write it to exam, they won't cut your mark. that when you move across a period, again, I'm writing it to help you all, everyone, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine. I'm writing their effective nuclear charge as well. And what do we see here? That when we move in a period, my number of shells remain same. My number of shells in all of it is 2, because that belongs to period number 2. But effective nuclear charge increases, my nucleus is pulling the electron more and more strongly. So their tendency, their ease to lose the electron decreases, right? So metallic character, that means electropositive character, decreases as tendency to lose electron increases as nuclear charge increases. Pulling of the electron is more stronger, and then it's not easy to donate it. Okay? So tendency to lose electron decreases, metallic character decreases. Down the group, let's talk about the same as I told you. When we move down the group, nuclear charge experienced by a valence electron is decreasing because there are too many shells in between. My nucleus is not able to hold the last electron very strongly due to more and more number of shells. So now, to decrease that electron, it's pretty easy. Let's talk about this only. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, and cesium. So 2-1, right? 2-8-1. 2-8-8-1. 2-8-18-8-1. And so on. The purpose is number of shell increases. My nucleus is not able to hold the last electron very tightly as it's very far. The ease to lose electron increases. Ease to lose electron increases means metallic character increases. Metallic character increases. And vice versa, that means non-metallic character decreases. So in the every period, the very first element is maximum metallic, and that very first element is group number 1. In that group itself, the last member will be maximum metallic as metallic character increases into the group. So cesium is the one, some books says francium also, just follow your NCRT. Generally francium is the one that's radioactive, and we don't count radioactive elements while discussing this, so you can say francium, but I would suggest cesium is the one most metallic because francium is radioactive. Anyways, not stable at all. Alright. So, I hope in group also that's pretty much clear. That in group, metallic character increases, non-metallic character decreases. As I told you, 17th group will be the one. This first will be the one, maximum metallic. And 17th will be the one, maximum non-metallic. Right, everyone? Now, what do I have to say? I have to say that in terms of this, that metallic character decreases and non-metallic character decreases increases, in that 17th group, which is maximum non-metallic, we start with fluorine, then chlorine, bromine, iodine. And when we see, when we talk about this particular period as, I mean particular group as well, what do I want to say? That every time one more and more shell increasing, what will happen to non-metallic character? As discussed, that my nucleus is not able to attract the upcoming electron more strongly as number of shell increases. So when you move down, as number of shell increases, my nucleus is not able to put enough force of attraction on upcoming electron. So this non-metallic character tendency to gain electron decreases. That means non-metallic character decreases. Electronegative character decreases. That means fluorine is the one most metallic, most electronegative element. Cesium is the one, or you must say francium, most metallic. That is most metallic, that is most non-metallic. Alright, as you see, this is the graph that's showing that non-metallic character is like this diagonally. That here is maximum non-metallic character. Here is the minimum non-metallic character, and vice versa. Metallic character increases in this way. Here is maximum metallic and here is minimum metallic. So yes, do you want me to conclude it? I'm concluding it as well. Metallic character decreases. That means electropositive character decreases. Non-metallic character increases. That means electronegative character increases. When I talk this to this, metallic character increases and non-metallic decreases. Fine? Very good, very good. There's also one more concept that I wanted to tell you before this topic of electronegativity, that when we talk about this periodic table, I can also explain chemical reactivity as well. What exactly is chemical reactivity? How much reactive these elements are, and that's totally based on their valence electron, that's totally based on their ease of losing and gaining electron. So as I define the valency, students, if you are able to remember that, one valency, two valency, here three, here four, and then valency will be 3, 2, 1, 0, right? So valency can also define their ease of losing and gaining electron, or I must say +1, +2, +3, 4, -3, -2, -1. +1 means it has to lose one electron, and the ease to lose one electron is very easy. 2 a bit difficult, 3 a more difficult, 4 yeah, difficult at all. So can I say chemical reactivity is first of all decreasing up to here? Why? They have this tendency to lose electron, and that's what decreasing. Reactivity is this only tendency to lose or gain or share so that they can combine with the other element. 3, 2, 1. This has maximum tendency, maximum ease to gain an electron. That means they are most reactive towards the gain of one electron. And that means again chemical reactivity is somewhat increasing. So I can say again group 1 maximum reactive. Maximum reactive metals, losing tendency maximum. Group 17, maximum maximum reactive non-metals. All right, maximum reactive non-metals, maximum tendency to gain electron. And what about reactivity? That means reactivity first decreases, then increases. What about a group? As valency same, somehow you can say chemical reactivity remains same, but you can also connect it like losing electron. When you are losing electron, the tendency to lose electron increases, the tendency to gain electron decreases. In the same term, you can define for the group, and do let me know your answer in the comment section. What will happen for the same into a group? I will wait for your answer. I gave you already an enough hint to solve it. All right, let's talk about electronegativity now. What exactly is electronegativity? It's very interesting topic. That's nothing but tendency of an atom to pull electron. But ma'am, that was non-metallic character. Please read it out. Tendency of an atom to pull electron towards itself from a shared pair in a covalent bond. I taught about covalent bond in chapter number 4. Suppose I'm talking about that methane gas, if you remember, that CH4. I hope you remember that. At least please revise. Okay, so whenever a bond is formed, a covalent bond is formed, you remember that covalent bond is formed by sharing of electron between two atoms. Suppose I'm talking about this carbon hydrogen. Suppose I'm talking about CCl4, carbon tetrachloride, 4 chlorine. I'm talking about this shared pair of electron where carbon and chlorine share their electron and make a stable covalent bond. So electronegativity is tendency of an atom to attract the shared pair of electron more towards itself while making this covalent bond. That means if one of the element among the two is having more tendency to attract the electron, they'll attract it towards itself and get a small delta negative charge. And whosoever element is, you know, pushing it away, that's get a delta positive charge. Delta is very tiny, positive, like a small tiny positive charge, because electrons are pushed from this side to other side, and this light negative charge. All right, so you should know which element is having more tendency to attract electron. Definitely depend upon their valence electron, that just to follow their octet, complete their octet, they are trying to gain the electron. All right, so I told you that non-metals are electronegative. That's pretty much obvious. That means when you move from left to right, let me write all the members. Let's take now third period. Okay, so this is 281, your sodium, then I'm writing magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur and chlorine. 281, 282, 283, 284, 285, 286 and 287. What I wanted to tell you that when you move from left to right, you see that their tendency to gain electron increases. Their tendency to gain electron increases. So even if they'll make a bond with other atom, they'll be more having this tendency to attract those electron from the shared pair. That means while moving into a period, my electronegativity increases. My EN, in short, you can say that my electronegativity increases in this particular period, chlorine. If I talk about second period, that will be fluorine. So in short, you can say 17th group member will be most electronegative and first group most electropositive, or you should say least electronegative. Alright, when I talk about group 1, they have a tendency to lose electron, not gain. So maximum electropositive, or I should say least electronegative. It's written also electronegativity increases from left to right. What about a particular group? Electronegativity, that is tendency to gain electron, that decreases. Okay, why? Again, tendency to pull the upcoming electron is decreases because your nucleus is not able to hold it because it's very far due to increase in number of shell. So overall, 17th period is maximum electronegative, but in that period also, when you move down, your tendency to attract electron decreases. That means fluorine is the one maximum electronegative. Fluorine is the one that's maximum electronegative. Does it make sense? I hope it is, because somehow we talked about all the trends. Electronegativity trend overall, you can say, is this. That means here minimum, here maximum, that to fluorine. All right. So I hope whatever I taught you today, which is super, super important, is super, super clear in your mind. There are a few trends that was not there in your syllabus for at least NCERT for CBSE. Still, there will be some videos available on our channel from the last year, NTSC and all, where you can talk about more and more trends like ionization energy, electron gain, enthalpy and all, but not regarding to your CBSE syllabus. Okay, there is something important, and yay to tell you that you might have seen those blooper videos where I used to say that we are not on Telegram, I mean Instagram, no, we are on Telegram. So ma'am is there on Vedantu handle on Instagram as well, chemistry.vedantu_anubha. I mean Anubha Gaur, you can follow me, you can take a screenshot. I'll try to be active. I just started it, where I will post all the upcoming lectures so that you will be stay tuned all the time that which lecture is going to come. And you can see all the BTS things behind the scenes and some interesting part and some science videos as well. So you can follow ma'am on the same. chemistry.vedantu_anubha_gaur. And there's a homework for all of you. I will not spare you like this. By considering their position in the periodic table, which one of the following element would you expect to have maximum metallic character? Gallium, germanium, arsenic, selenium and barium. A bit, you know, tricky, but I know you'll solve it. You can take a screenshot, you can pause the video and can read it out properly. I will wait for your responses and for all the questions that I've asked in between the session. So students, this is done. I know you must be thinking, ma'am, practice, what kind of a question will come? Don't worry, sprint series is coming. We will practice a lot. So next session will be a mentee session. We'll take your doubts of this particular chapter as well. And this is done with Vedantu. That is possible that we can get results from all the corners of India, as Vedantu bagged 548 ranks across India. All the students of Vedantu bagged. 1 out of 3 students who cleared JEE mains with Vedantu able to clear JEE advance as well, which is amazing. Neat result, amazing. And your beautiful picture can be here as well if you'll trust and have faith in yourself and on this amazing platform. I proudly say I'm a proud Vedan. So for that, you can take a scholarship where Vedantu is giving up to 100% scholarship in total worth almost 100 crores. So 3 p.m. every Sunday from 25th October to 29th October, from grade 6 to all 13th, you all can enroll for the same. Do not miss it, everyone. And for Vedantu Pro courses, which is as amazing as I told you, just open the description box that was pinned by Vedantu. Get your pro course link and select 10th class CBSE 2021 as your grade and take your subscription for 1-3-6 months according to your suitability. All our best, but I must say 1 in 3, because 6 months, you know, that much time. But 3 months will be best for all the fast track and crash course revision. 1 month if you want to go for some small tiny things. But do not forget to apply this code AGEPRO, because that is giving you discount from 20% to 31%. See the price. It's like 8 to 10 rupees per session. So do not miss it, everyone. This is me, Anubha Gaur, signing it off for today. I hope everything is clear. So stay tuned. Do not forget to like the video, share it to your friends so that it will reach to everyone. And definitely subscribe to the channel. Happy learning, my lovely people. Happy learning.